In recent years, we've been witnessing an increasing number of extreme weather events. Heat waves, droughts, fires, floods, affecting urban and rural areas in equal measure, affecting peoples and their lives. These are the undoubtable results of climate change, and they show over and over that avoiding and reducing emissions to prevent the planet from warming further is not enough. Now, calls for investment adaptation measures at a global scale are not new. In fact, since 2010, there is agreement among the UN community and parties that mitigation and adaptation need to go hand in hand. In other words, there is agreement that adaptation must be addressed with the same level of priority and urgency as mitigation. But that even balance has been difficult to achieve so far. And finance for adaptation continues to make up only about 20% of the climate finance overall. That is very little. Knowing this, it comes to no surprise that the Secretary General of the UN, Antonio Guterres, has asked all donors and multilateral development banks to increase funding allocation towards adaptation and resilience to 50%. That is $50 billion out of $100 billion US dollars pledge. He also urged them to make it easier for countries affected by natural disasters to access the funding they need. This year's climate change conference, COP26, had a challenging task to galvanize support and instill action, meaningful action, that includes funneling resources towards adaptation, especially in the regions that are most in need. Big international donors like the GCF and the World Bank have already redirected their investment strategies. They are already acting on the 50% call and looking at the most vulnerable. But often, we have limited understanding of the risks that the most vulnerable regions are facing. Financial decisions that are impactful need to be context-specific. To do that, they need to reflect both socioeconomic and climate conditions of the communities they're meant for. Decision makers thus need adequate information for adaptation planning. So today, we want to find answers to the tough questions. How feasible is it to address the needs of those most vulnerable? How can one support local decision makers define the adaptation strategies when seeking financing options? I am Anna Adi. This is the report on quantifying adaptation for the most vulnerable and the role of community networks. Joining me today is an exciting group of experts. They will reflect on ongoing efforts to make climate analytics more easily accessible for decision makers around the world. Now, tools have been developed to help inform financial decisions. One of them is the Economics of Climate Adaptation Framework, also known as the ECA. And it is an open-source decision-making support tool that incorporates stakeholder engagement with climate risk analysis and cost efficiency assessments of adaptation measures. This information clip contains more details.
Extreme weather events threaten urban and rural areas, from small regions to entire nations. The Economics of Climate Adaptation, in short ECA, offers a unique framework for the flexible identification of cost-effective climate adaptation measures. Understanding climate risk is the first step in developing an effective adaptation strategy. Decision makers face the following questions. What are our climate risks today and in the coming decades? How can we deal with these risks and which adaptation measures are appropriate? Which investments are necessary and do the benefits outweigh the costs? ECA, together with Climada, an open source modeling platform, helps to answer these questions. Climada simulates the impact of thousands of hazard events on assets and people, taking into account their vulnerabilities. It provides a robust analysis of the costs and benefits of adaptation, supporting decision makers with a fact base to design their adaptation strategy. Adding national and local knowledge further improves the quality of Climada's outputs. Climada's output can be customized to cover the needs of a variety of stakeholders. By using these outputs, the economics of climate adaptation supports decision makers in unlocking climate finance and developing national adaptation plans, or NAPs, and other adaptation strategies, such as ecosystem-based adaptation, infrastructure, community-based adaptation, or risk transfer. These outputs make a strong case for climate action, as it is often less costly to start adapting now rather than waiting. So take action now. Please visit eca-network.org for more information on the economics of climate adaptation.
So now that we've seen how ECA works, we've brought in the studio Maxime Souvignet. He's the team lead at ECA here at UN University in Bonn to tell us how the ECA framework has been implemented. Tell us, Maxime, a little bit more. How does it work? How has it been implemented? Where in the world has it been implemented?
Yeah, good morning, Anna. Thank you very much. So actually, the economics of climate adaptation has been developed 10 years ago by ETH, a university, and Swiss Re, a reinsurance company. It has been applied since in more than 20 different countries. Recently, it has gained a lot of momentum with projects developed and co-financed by large development banks such as KfW or ADB, the Asian Development Bank. So for instance, it's applied currently in Honduras, in the municipal sector, in Ethiopia for agriculture, and also in Vietnam, but also in larger regions such as the CARIC region.
So Maxime, the tool is complex and it can be used by a variety of stakeholders, ideally in local communities where it can have most impact. So how can local stakeholders use this? Do you have any examples of what is needed to make the tool work at its best?
Yeah, thank you very much. So there are different things that are actually needed in order to enable local stakeholders, local community to use and to apply this tool. The first thing is data. There is a large amount of data which is needed in order to start working with this model. But that's not all of it. So the second thing which is also needed is the involvement of all different type of stakeholders. Many of them never worked before together, such as academia, the private sector, the finance sector, but also the policymakers that need to come together at a very early stage in the process.
And I imagine, you know, when you bring people that are from such different fields, that getting them to work together and speak the same language, so get used to the same terminology, is a challenge. Does the ECA framework support that, taking them in a sense through the paces of how do we speak the same language in order to achieve the same goals?
Yeah, that's definitely a challenge, but it doesn't mean it cannot be overcome. And one of the strength of ECA is then bringing them together by, for instance, being an open source platform. So everything which is developed under the ECA platform is open source and ready to use for any stakeholders, any communities. Of course, it comes also with another challenge attached to that, how can these communities, and some of them lack capacities, resources to use these technical tools, and how can we actually enable them to use this tool? And to answer your question, this is what we are trying to do with a sort of a community of practice, a group of experts. We call that the ECA network, which brings together experts, stakeholders, best practices in order to achieve this enablement of local communities and local stakeholders.
Oh, so that's great. So you have the tool, but you also have the network that underpins the tool. And because the tool is open source, you also have a lot of people within this network to support further development and capacity building. That's quite brilliant. Well, thank you, Maxime. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anna.
We now move to Zurich to hear about Climada, the modeling tool that you've heard spoken about in the clip before. And to do that, we're going to talk with Professor Dr. David Bresch. He's a full professor for weather and climate risk at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, ETH Zurich, and Meteo Swiss since 2016. And before that, he's worked with Swiss Re, among others, being head of business development and global head sustainability. Now, his research focuses on the impacts of weather and climate on socioeconomic systems, which is why we're talking with him today. David, hello and welcome.
Thanks, pleasure from my side.
So, David, tell us a little bit more about Climada. What is it and how does it work?
So, Climada stands for climate adaptation, and it's in essence a platform on which one can look at the impact of both economic development as well as climate change to a particular risk landscape anywhere on the globe. So, it can be tropical cyclones, floods, wildfires, you name it. And this, all implemented in Python, allows a user to basically construct a development scenario, look into climate change and how that affects the severity and frequency of, say, a flood event, and then you look at the impact of that particular hazard to a particular region on the globe. And the nice thing, it doesn't stop just at, you might say, the price tag or the impact side of the story. It also allows users to appraise adaptation options. Means you can put in this tool things you might consider doing in order to reduce the impact of a particular hazard on a particular local community, say. And so you can look at a basket of adaptation options and compare their effectiveness to reduce risk. Again, almost anywhere on the planet and in all kinds of circumstances.
Now that you've clarified that, could you tell us a little bit how Climada can help bridge between academic and scientific thinking and action into these communities?
Yeah, basically, there are quite some studies looking at impacts in that first order. Say, they say there's so much of a change in hazard intensity, be it flood height, or so much of a change in frequency of something happening. But what often is relevant for decision makers is to know, how does it affect me directly and more precisely? So geospatially explicit means you're really in a city and like to know what's going to hit me. But even more importantly, for many decision makers, and that's what's been doing since the last almost 10 years, when we looked at the economics of adaptation, they also ask, what does it cost us? Which options are most effectful to reduce risk? So it starts from a risk landscape today, and then it charts out pathways of development, brings them into context of climate impact scenarios, and helps therefore decision makers to appraise their options, means to figure what kind of subset of options might be most powerful to mitigate risk in a particular situation.
And finally, how can ECA Network support all this work?
Yeah, we've set up and kind of built the Economics of Climate Adaptation, short ECA or ECA Network, because nobody can do that alone or in isolation. We can provide the underpinning, means the engine, the Climada tool. We also provide some kind of guidance with a guidebook, which is openly accessible. And as was mentioned before, all the data and all the code we produce is all open access and obviously open source, so free to use for anybody, even for commercial applications. And that network helps us spread the news, build the relationships, and basically also join forces to basically live up, rise up to the adaptation challenge in many places. So it's probably a bit of a, like a place you can go shopping and say, has somebody done something similar nearby? Could I reach out? Might that be something for me? And also important to also discuss limitations of these approaches, as there are no panacea, and you need to deeply engage with stakeholders. And again, therefore, I think a network is the most important element in making progress.
Thank you, David, very, very much. Our next guest is Professor Dr. Ulf Moslehner. He's a professor at the Frankfurt School of Finance and Management, and he's also the head of research of the UNEP Collaborating Center for Climate and Sustainable Energy Finance. We're going to talk to him about financial literacy. Ulf, thank you for joining us. Hello.
Welcome. Thank you for having me.
Now, Ulf, we have spoken today and we've realized how important climate finance is for climate action. But how important is climate literacy and financial literacy for adaptation? Help us a little bit with clarifying that.
Yeah. It's actually, when we think about adaptation, you know, this is all about reacting to climate change, and climate change is, you know, all about statistics, a lot about statistics, like particularly adaptation, bad things that might happen or might happen more often. And this, you know, is actually, that's really very much at the heart of where finance can help, basically converting like rare catastrophes into small but manageable cash flows, basically, for example, for insurance premium. And that's why this is super important for adaptation, I guess, for at least two reasons. Obvious one, first, you know, deal with the already existing risks by trying to, for example, design insurance instruments. But also, and that's where it becomes potentially even more important in the long term, by introducing this forward-looking component, because informed insurance premia, they make market risks or climate risks transparent, and they actually deliver price signals, and they help to consider those risks, those risks in the decisions. That's where it's also very important, and sort of that's also why financial literacy is so important, in the sense of understanding and interpreting, you know, those signals that financial market sends. And it's quite important in adaptation, or when adapting economies and societies to climate change, to have this long-term perspective.
So where do you see a gap, and how do we address it?
Well, when we think about these risks and how they materialize, what their impact is, they're already quite a number of tools available out there, but it's tough. It might be complicated to use them. That is where I would see a gap. So being able to use those tools, methods, models, if you want, those complete frameworks. And then in the second step, also communicating those results, what you've learned and the benefits, potentially best practice situations, communicating those to decision makers. That would be an important second gap I would like to see addressed. And this is actually also where we all as members of the ECA network can really help.
So Maxime, we've heard from practitioners how they use the tool, how they thought about it, but you've mentioned earlier that ICA is a tool for decision making. So for practitioners, for policymakers. So I wonder if you have any stories and examples of how the tool has been helping decision-making processes live in communities that needed it most.
Yeah, you're right. ICA is a tool for decision-makers. And a tool for adaptation is only good if it leads to policy. We will not solve adaptation just with a tool. We need policymakers, decision makers, to actually base their decision on the outcomes of this tool. We had recently a project going on in Honduras, in the municipality of San Pedro Sula, and the city has been hit by a series of hurricanes in late 2020. And I'd like us actually to have a look at the story told by the mayor of the city, Mr. Caledonio, right now.
Well, let's do that.
El riesgo, creo que incrementa mucho el riesgo de las inundaciones catastróficas. Ya no son inundaciones normales, sino que inundaciones ya con mucha fuerza en barrios y colonias, y llega a lugares donde antes no había llegado. Vemos también la concentración de agua, o sea, de una lluvia, de una tormenta mucho más agresiva en corto tiempo que en general, hasta en los lugares más desarrollados, colapsan los sistemas pluviales, no digamos en nuestras ciudades. Por otro lado, nosotros vivimos en San Pedro Sula, una ciudad que es con una temperatura promedio de 32 grados, y creemos que esas temperaturas están subiendo posiblemente un grado en promedio, y eso es una, requiere una gran cantidad de energía, pero al mismo tiempo nos afecta también la parte del medio ambiente, porque se incrementan también los incendios forestales, pero no solamente eso, sino que los incendios forestales llegan a lugares más altos dentro de las reservas y los parques nacionales. Las enfermedades también, hay un incremento de enfermedades de la piel, respiratorias, vectoriales, y bueno, ya sabemos lo que está pasando ahorita también, eso puede tener un efecto. Y esperamos que, estamos esperando en este mes, a partir de este mes de junio hasta noviembre, que es el época ciclónica, un efecto, el efecto de este efecto conocido como la Niña, en los cuales es posible que tengamos, podemos llegar hasta tener hasta influencia de 4 huracanes y más de 15 tormentas tropicales. Yo estoy muy, muy agradecido. Es un proyecto muy importante para nosotros. La verdad que esa es la realidad, y por eso le hemos dado una gran prioridad. Nos vamos a preocupar mucho por mantener motivados a todas las personas, aunque la gente que está participando tiene un gran compromiso con el tema de ambiente en nuestra ciudad. Y queremos también que lo que estamos haciendo nosotros en San Pedro Sula tengamos definitivamente un factor multiplicador también, porque lo que se hace realmente con esta metodología nos sirve a nosotros para tomar decisiones, ¿verdad? Saber dónde son nuestros puntos de vulnerabilidad, nuestros riesgos climáticos, y tener esos estudios económicos para poder determinar qué poder hacer. Así que todo a través de ECA, la municipalidad también podrá accesar también a fondos importantes, y por eso también nosotros nos interesa mucho, porque hemos estado haciendo mucho por el ambiente. Tenemos un gran compromiso, pero no, nunca va a ser nada suficiente. Entonces, este momento de COVID, pues el ambiente como que ha tenido un verdadero respiro, ¿verdad?
That was very informative. Maxime, thank you so, so very much. We'll continue here with other guests.
Thank you.
Let's talk about unlocking climate finance. And to do that, we're going to talk with our next guest, Dr. Coco Warner, who's a manager at the UN Climate Change. She's also the founder and former executive director at the Munich Climate Insurance Initiative. Coco, welcome, and thank you for joining us.
Hi, Anna, it's a pleasure.
Now, Coco, how do you think ECA and the ECA network could contribute to balance out the investment gap between mitigation and adaptation, especially for those most vulnerable?
We're hours away, or a couple of days past the closing of COP26 in Glasgow. And you see headlines all over about big commitments that have been made on the mitigation side around methane, phasing down coal, forests, all of this really good work on the mitigation side. And you also heard a lot of disappointment, particularly from least developed countries, small island development states and others, saying, hey, we really need finance for adaptation. We're really already feeling the adverse impacts of climate change. So what's needed? I think that ECA and the work that you're doing is really essential to help show or help countries become much more specific about their needs and be able to communicate that with the finance institutions that want to provide adaptation finance. It's just critical. Even more critical is, since we're the United Nations, we don't want to leave anyone behind. And often the most vulnerable are exactly the ones who don't get consulted and may not have enough opportunities to participate. And that's something that ECA is doing. It's consulting with communities. It's helping show what the risks are, understand what community priorities and preferences are. And that consultation process is totally aligned with this idea of inclusive adaptation and just inclusive multilateralism, leaving no one behind and making sure that the means of implementation are adequate to the needs.
And Coco, how do you think, I mean, why is it so important to enhance collaboration and share best practice?
when we talk about adaptation to climate change and building resilience, it's a global endeavor. There's not a community or a country or a region that isn't affected already today by adverse climate impacts. It's important to share information, share good practice, enhance collaboration, if nothing more than the fact that we now have to move at a massive, rapid scale to help countries adapt and avert and minimize and address these adverse climate impacts. And those are unfolding. One of the interesting things about the ICA is its networks. And from what we've learned about innovation from the surging world of technology and business and other realms is that when people come together, they have a tendency to exchange experience, say what's working, what's not, what the norms are, and they come up with new ideas, new and better ideas to test. And that's very much what we need to do now to help countries adapt to climate change. That inclusivity and the networks is an absolutely essential ingredient.
Thank you, Coco. That's it from us. Thank you very much for joining us. So let's close the gap. Ekosue Yahen is the Secretary General of the Insurance Development Forum, and with her we're going to talk about finance and insurance. Ekosue, thank you for joining us today and making time for us. Now, Ekosue, tell me a little bit, how can the finance sector enable adaptation in developing countries?
Okay, thank you for the great question. Climate finance plays a critical role in helping developing countries fight climate change and adapt to its impact. I think in 2009, developed countries agreed to mobilize $100 billion in climate finance per year by 2020. And in 2015, they agreed to extend this goal through to 2025. While there has been significant, I think, mobilization and scale up of support over the last decade, new analysis shows that we are not actually going to be able to meet the $100 billion target. And it will also likely fall short in 2021 and 2022. What has clearly emerged is that private climate finance has also underperformed in terms of expectations. So it's clear that there's more that needs to be done in terms of how we mobilize private finance towards the adaptation agenda. For developing countries, this is a real challenge because without bolder steps in terms of addressing mitigation, there will be really an expanded need for financing for adaptation. And so there is an impetus in terms of the global community really trying to figure out how we mobilize private to help support the adaptation finance needs of developing countries. In this context, as you mentioned, insurance has an important role to play. As an industry, the insurance industry in general is built on risk management, and the risk assessment and risk capacity capabilities that exist within the industry could actually be quite important when we think about how do we bring transparency to these risks and also help to drive capital in an appropriate direction when we think about adaptation. As an example, for the V20 countries, they've explicitly identified the financial protection gap as a huge issue for them. And to close this financial protection gap, they've gone as far as to identify the need for risk and resilience analytics and the importance of that to help drive the support of finance for adaptation. And I think that at this point in time, there is really a critical urgency to think about how do we bring together a coalition of actors to work with developing countries to respond to their demands, to help them to understand these risks better with the objective of using the information that we can generate to drive finance for adaptation, but also just generally support better risk management capabilities within these countries and also investments.
And in this context, how do you think collaborative networks can be of support?
So collaborative networks are obviously an absolute necessity in achieving the climate adaptation goals. The challenge of climate change is its complexity and obvious absolute requirements for collective action. And collective action must be at the heart in terms of how we think about addressing this issue. So this is why at COP26, the IDF and partners announced three major programs focused on this issue of how do we bring the insurance industry's risk assessment and risk analytics capabilities to address the needs that we are seeing in developing countries. So there are three programs that we launched at COP26. The first is really a partnership between the IDF and the V20 group of countries and 48 climate vulnerable countries to build risk analytics capabilities where it is essentially needed the most. Through the use of insurance-based methodologies, tools, and experience, countries will be able to generate local ownership of the risk analysis, an essential foundation for mainstreaming climate and disaster risk finance. This will involve the launch of what we are referring to as the Global Risk Modeling Alliance, and with a focus again on how do we increase and improve the capability through partnership with these governments and sovereign entities of better understanding risk and better management of these risks. So as part of that, there are several elements to this Global Risk Modeling Alliance. The first is a commitment to open source technology and standards provided by industry, but also optimized for public sector use cases. A second component of this is a public good fund to help countries fill the model and data gaps. Again, an important part of the piece when we think about adaptation and risk analytics. And a third component is a technical assistance team of public and private sector practitioners to work with countries on applied projects. So the Global Risk Modeling Alliance will apply open data standards throughout, thereby enabling countries to build and share and further develop views across ministries, disaster risk management authorities, and research institutions so that we can get across the board a better understanding of what the risks are that they face. The second commitment, which we launched at COP26, is to establish what we're referring to as the Global Resilience Index, which is, again, a multi-partner initiative, which will provide a globally consistent model for the assessment of resilience across all sectors and geographies. It will be curated, open source, offering high-level metrics across the built environment, infrastructure, agriculture, and societal exposures with many potential applications in aggregated risk management worldwide. And I think that this, again, is quite important when we think about not only supporting ground-up risk modeling capabilities, but also having available high-level metrics that can give an indication of the resilience level that exists in many of the countries that we are really most interested in working with in terms of addressing the adaptation challenge. The third area that we announced a partnership in is increasing support to the humanitarian sector, and notably a growing partnership that we have with START Network and a new humanitarian financing facility, which aims to help communities get ahead of escalating climate risks through prearranged disaster risk financing. As we know, with the increase in disasters that we are seeing, there's also a corresponding need for humanitarian assistance. And within those communities, there's also a need to think about how do we improve the availability of financing to support humanitarian intervention. And so what we are trying to do within the IDF is to actually foster a coalition of actors from across the public sector, academia, civil society, to begin to think through the architecture and the foundation that is required when we think about risk analytics and how that fundamentally feeds into the provision of finance. So I hope that addresses your question when we think about the question of climate adaptation and really the need for investing in foundations that are required for the transformation that's necessary to support resilience in the climate vulnerable countries. So thank you for that.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure to be here, to be part of this community and to share the work that we are doing within the IDF. But as I said before, it's all about collective action. So being part of this convening is an important part of our process and our ability to actually be successful. So thank you for that.
So we've spoken earlier about the network and practitioners and the tool, but let's now move on and speak about the private sector and how they use or how they could use the items that we've spoken about. So Claudia Thyme is our next guest. She's a VP, Director of Strategic Market Development at AXA XL, Insurance Development Forum and Insure Resilience Global Partnership. Claudia, thank you for joining us and welcome.
Hello, Anna, and thank you for inviting me to be part of this series.
So tell me, what role can the private and finance sector in particular play in making vulnerable countries more resilient to climate risks?
So, Anna, I think that, first of all, I can speak, of course, to the role of insurers. And talking about the insurance sector, there are many different things that we can do. But I believe that the most important and really foundational role that that we can and must play is to enable sovereign and sub-sovereign governments access to risk analytics and understanding of their own risks and providing risk data and risk tools. Because to advance adaptation and align financial flows with climate resilient development, we need a shared understanding of the risks across society. And to adapt and build resilience, countries, cities, and communities require greater access to risk analytics, as only risks that are understood can be quantified, that are understood and quantified, can be managed to protect their populations. Yet we have this paradox whereby most investment in risk analytics is in the global north, while it is most needed in the global south. And without a solid understanding of this risk, developing nations and vulnerable nations are hard-pressed to prioritize effectively the risk, the resilience investment, where they should focus, and more importantly, to attract both public and private investment. So here, as AXA, we announced a really important effort during COP26. As a founding member of the Ocean Risk and Resilience Action Alliance, we announced the launch of the Coastal Resilience Index as a public good for use by all. So meaning natural governments, city planners, regulators, investors, and more. And the CRI, quantifies the impact of sea level rise and storm surge and provides a new, more detailed way to assess coastal flooding in the context of climate change. It shows the impact of storm surge with and without coastal ecosystems, so mainly mangroves and coral. And the CRO, it also models coastal flooding at different levels of severity and in different conditions now in the present and also for 2030 and 2050. So these are the type of tools that I believe, like ECA, very much very important for local communities, that we as the insurance industry can provide, working with our partners, with scientists and other partners, to use this information and make it available.
Thank you, Claudia, for joining us. Now, we've spoken earlier with Maxime, who is leading the ICA team at the UN University in Bonn, about the network and about the platform. But UN University in Bonn is one of the hosts and the promoters of the entire idea. They've developed space, they've developed resources, and they're very committed to taking both the ICA network and the ICA platform further. And so to explore their plans and to explore their ideas, I've also invited Dr. Zita Sebeshvari. She's the Deputy Director of UNUEHS and the Head of Section, Environment, Vulnerability and Ecosystem Services. Zita, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So Zita, tell me a little bit more about the relationship the UN University here in Bonn has developed with the ICA network and the ICA framework. And how do you work? How do you support the network? And how does this work for you?
Thank you for the opportunity to talk about our involvement. So ICA is a science-based tool which aims to help decision makers to find the best mix of adaptation solutions. And this is where UNU is really interested to be part of the network, to contribute. We do work based on science, on finding good adaptation solutions, and to bring this into this very interesting and very implementation-oriented tool is our genuine interest. So giving you an example, for my team is working on ecosystem-based adaptation, and that was an element which was missing in the ICA tool. So the idea was to work together jointly and actually try to find best solutions how the tool can be enriched with science-based solutions to include ecosystem-based adaptation measures into the overall mix of adaptation solutions. Zooming out a little bit, of course, the aim and the goals of the ICA network are very close to our mandate. So we aim to help vulnerable countries, vulnerable stakeholders to find best solutions to adapt to the adverse impacts of climate change, and having a tool and a network at hand which can help to reach out to the right stakeholders and to provide the right solutions is our best interest. So we are very happy to engage, we are very happy to support the network and the further development of the tool, and happy to host the initiative all together. Thank you.
Thank you, Zita, very, very much for all those very informative answers. Maxime, wonderful to have you back. We've heard from practitioners and decision makers about how they use the ICA framework. But you've also mentioned a network, and the network is made out of many parts, usually dispersed around the world, people actually, that need to work with one another. So I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about what's in it for the ICA members. What is it so special about being part of the network?
Well, thank you. First of all, we want the ICA network to be a dynamic network. We want the members to co-develop this network. That's very important to us. But I think at the core, there are four added values to its members that are important and makes this network attractive. The first one is showcasing case studies. To showcase what is feasible, what can be done in different type of sectors. That's the first thing that we offer. The second thing is in terms of updates, what's new for the framework itself, but also for Climada, the tool actually powering the ICA network. New modules, new development, for instance, for droughts, for heat waves, improvements, etc. That's the second thing. The third thing is when you want to perform an ICA study, you need experts. And we are offering a database of experts in different regions and for different sectors. That's what the network actually should aim at. And the third thing, because we want this to be dynamic, is we need to foster a dialogue between different stakeholders, and then we want to offer regular meetings at different venues throughout the year.
So updates, access to experts, a database as well as of knowledge, and continuous dialogue. That sounds exciting. But now that you mentioned dialogue, that also means that you have plans for the future. So I wonder, what are the plans for the ICA network and for ICA in general?
Yeah, thank you for asking. Actually, we have a lot of plans on the table for the future. I'll try to name only a few. So the first one, which is dearest to us, is to explore using the economics of climate adaptation, how we can actually address impacts on non-monetary assets, such as access to school or access to health, because they matter to vulnerable people. How can we quantify what is not quantifiable, which has no monetary values? We want to explore that and take the challenge. That's one thing. The second thing is we would like to explore further what it means maladaptation. What does it mean when we are doing adaptation measures, offering coming out of an ICA study, and they have negative effects more than positive effects? So far, it is not included, and we want to further develop the framework to make sure it doesn't happen. At the same time, we want to make sure the positive effect, what is called co-benefits of adaptation, are included. To give you an example, when we are using ecosystem-based adaptation, mangrove development, for instance, then this mangrove has co-benefits in terms of landscaping. It's good for tourism, and it could also create new jobs in the regions. that's the second thing. Another thing we'd like to explore is development of new modules. This is more technical, but how can we include risk transfer and insurance inside ICA in much better that is done now? This is something we are working on. We also explore different sectors, new sectors. To give you just two examples, the first one would be the private sector. The private sector is impacted not only where the factory is, but throughout the value chain. Mm-hmm. Production and delivery and also transport. What happens if the roads are impacted but not the factory? What does it mean in terms of production, in terms of jobs, etc.? And we would like to have this approach included in the ICA framework as well. And the second example I was mentioning before, ecosystem-based adaptation. It is a very challenging endeavor to monetize ecosystems. It's also very political, but we would like to take this challenge and take this further. So I'm very much looking forward to all these things and also others, I think.
Sounds very, very exciting. So good luck with that. And thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Anna.
So this is it. This concludes our report on quantifying adaptation for the most vulnerable and the role of community networks. We started today asking the difficult questions of how can we address the needs of those most vulnerable and how can we support decision makers in their endeavors. We highlighted the ICA framework, underpinned by research and support of the ICA network. It ensures local involvement to create long-term and transparent adaptation strategies. And it also brings together stakeholders from a variety of fields and areas. The guests joining us today are a testimony to that. So a big thank you to all for your time and input. A great big thank you from all of us. Now, I encourage you to take a look at what the ICA Network is doing at their online platform, ica-network.org. And while you're there, check out the work of the Institute for Environment and Human Security at the UN University in Bonn. They're doing fantastic work and they're part of the ICA network. And if you're working with resilience, adaptation and climate risk management, be it from the academic, government, development, private or funding sector's perspective, do consider joining the ICA network and support the work. As you've heard, their plans are ambitious and far-reaching, but implementing them needs collaboration, and so they might need you. I'm Anna Adi. Thank you for joining me today. Stay healthy and safe.